Well, good morning.
This is Cassidy, as I'm sure you figured out. And as I said last week when I put up a video, I said I'd really like to try doing more video work for my blog. So today I'm going to do something a little different. I'm going to videotape what I've been working on. And I've been busy, as you can see on the screen behind me. Now, I want to tell you right off the bat, if I look a little different this morning, it's because I'm not wearing makeup. And I've actually been out already. I've been out shopping at the store, and I stopped at Panera for breakfast. And I just decided I didn't need to put makeup on because, well, most women, when they just run out to do something, they don't throw on makeup. And I'm just like most women. So I'm getting, after 2 years, I've finally gotten to the point where I'm comfortable enough with myself and my body that I don't feel like I need to get all made up just to go out and pick up a few things. And after I'm done with this video, I'm actually going to run out and go buy a new bra, because the one I was wearing the other day at work actually began ripping. And guys who may be watching this, you do not know fear until you realize your bra is starting to come apart on you at work, and you may actually have to go into your boss's office and say, I have to go home for a little bit. I need to change my bra. Ladies, you know what I'm talking about. So anyway, what have I been working on? Well, what I want to show you is something rather important. I began plotting out the next novel, C for Continuing. And I'm not going to show it to you on this screen simply because, well, now I have a setup where I actually have a bigger monitor that I can show all this stuff to. And that's exactly what I'm going to do. I'm going to zoom you over here so you can actually see on my television what I've been doing. So hold on, let's do this. I'll be careful, I'll be good. I'll try not to zoom you too fast. Here we go, here we go, here we go, here we go, here we go. There we are. There's my TV set. And let's zoom in just a little bit. Nice and slow, mainly because I want to be able to get it all in frame. There we go. That is the layout for C for Continuing, the Foundation Chronicles, C for Continuing. And I did this last night. I actually sat down and spent about an hour and a half to 2 hours working on this. And this is what I have. Right now, how it's plotted out, it's all very meta. I have all three acts in place, and I have the different parts in place. I have not started putting in chapters yet, except in one area, and you will see where that's at because I'm going to show it to you. I'm doing like I did with the last two novels. This is going to be a three-act play, Act 1, Act 2, and Act 3. There will be, as of right now, 11 separate parts. That was how many I had in B for Bewitching. A for Advanced had 14, but that novel's also 425,000 words long. B for Bewitching ran 325. And I'm guessing, just based on past experience, that this novel is probably going to be as big as B for Bewitching. I know that Act 2 is going to be fairly large. And by fairly large, I mean there's going to be a lot going on. Act 1 is probably going to be the shortest. Act 3 may be pretty short too. But to me, when I say short, Act 1 and B for Bewitching was the shortest act there was in the entire book, and it was 88,000 words, which is a novel all by itself. So short for me is a relative term. Now, let me show you what I've got. We'll start in with the acts first. As you can see, we have three acts. And I had actually written some time ago what the acts were going to be called. Act 1 is Season of Change. And this is actually going to cover an area in the book from where we actually left off in B for Bewitching. I had stated before that this novel is pretty much going to pick up exactly where the last one started. Although, it's actually going to take a scene to get to that. You'll see what I mean when I put out the trailer, the teaser trailer for this novel. You'll see what I mean by that. So it's going to show how things are starting to change for the kids, how they're being affected by some of the things that are actually coming their way. Act two, let's just be honest, and I said this a while back as well, it is called Season of Hell for a reason. I have told other people, I have mentioned in some of the other blog posts that I've written, that this is going to really be a hard year for Annie and Carrie. And Season of Hell covers that. It actually covers a pretty good portion of the school year. And things are not going to be good for them. That's why I'm calling it Season of Hell. And you'll see what I mean when you see it. Act 3 is Season of Awakening. Originally, even last night, I had this name Season of Renewal. But then I began thinking this morning, what am I actually renewing? I'm not renewing anything. But Awakening indicates that by this time now, the kids know what sort of life is kind of going to be expected of them. Where they are going, where they are headed, what they are actually doing to get there. And there's also personal issues that are coming into play here. So they're awakening to this idea that, you know, even among people who are considered strange, and this was something that Carrie brought up last year with Annie, they are kind of even outsiders among their own peers. And so they're finally coming to grips with everything that's being thrown at them, you know. After everything they've went through this entire year, this is where they've gotten. So let's open up the chapters and we'll see where we're actually at in terms of what each part is. So right off the bat, four parts. Let me get this moved up just a little bit. There we go. Sorry about the jiggle. Okay, part one, simple enough, Summertime Blues. This is going to cover everything from the point of Carrie saying, Mom, Dad, I'm a witch, up until the point where they're actually getting their travel packages. And even a little beyond that, you'll see what I mean when I get into the writing. But this is actually going to cover most of the summer, the whole summer. Let's just put it that way. Part two is Paul Ricononde à Paris. Meet me in Paris. And this is going to detail the kids traveling to Paris, which is their rendezvous point for their sea levels, their time in Paris, their time coming over back over to America, and coming to Salem. Things will happen. Mostly strange things that will allow them to start getting their feet going. And thinking ahead, this is probably not going to be a big scene. I doubt very much if there's going to be more than two or three chapters in this part. But that's okay. Part three, reconnecting. And this is where you're going to see them coming back into the school. You're going to see them reconnecting with friends. You're going to see them reconnecting with instructors that they know. They're also going to have to become, as was passed on to them by Penny Alex and Jario the year before, they're going to have to become the kids in charge of the second floor. And they're going to have to greet the new B levels. And we're going to see, you know, just what sort of dynamics are going to start setting up between these new kids coming up from the first floor. They're going to be the ones that have the party for them and make them welcome and everything else, because they promised they would do that. And we're also going to see them going into a new class. The C levels are where the students actually begin taking some of their, I guess you could say, electives. As we know, only a few people are going into sorcery. Annie and Carrie, also in the C levels, are not going to be taking astronomy anymore. They're done with that, 2 years. They're not going to be taking earth science and botany, although they will have access to the greenhouse and stuff like that if they want it, and they probably will. Some of the kids, not Annie and Carrie, will be going over to the Tesla Science area to do science and magic training, and some of them will even find out that they had gifts. They'll go into gift training. Annie and Carrie don't need to do this, although Carrie will probably still be working a little bit on his mimic skill. His gift, I mean. But the one big change that's going to come here is they're going to take Deanna's class for the first time. Deanna teaches Introduction to Divination. I know. It's like, oh, well, didn't Harry Potter and those kids do the same thing in the third novel of their book? It just worked out this way. And Deanna, well, we already know what she's like, and she is not going to be some whacked out professor who gazes into crystal balls. We already know that's not Deanna. But you will find that the kids are back in their advanced classes. They're going to get pushed a little harder in her advanced classes. Erwin's actually going to start taking her advanced class now over into the Tesla Science Center. She did that a little in the B level, but we never noticed it because we never really went to classes that much. This time we're actually going to get to see like one of the big major labs, the super lab, so to speak, over in the Tesla Science Center, where if they want to produce like 200 pounds of meth, they can go full on Heisenberg and, do it. But yeah, they'll actually get a chance to work the super lab in the Tesla Science Center. Indiana has something else for them to do as well. You'll find out. Part 4, disconnections. And this is where things are going to start getting, I don't want to say bad, but you're going to start to see rivalries and other weird and strange things starting to pop up between them. We already know there are some kids who don't like Annie and Carrie, and this is going to start to come out even more and more. You will see this begin happening. So disconnections are, they're actually going to start engaging in these rivalries, and they're also going to start feeling, because of the pressure they're being put under to do things differently than the rest of the people in their level, they're going to start to feel disconnected even more and more from what's going on there. So that's the first act. Yay! And I've decided all my acts, when I do publish and sell them, they will go for $1.99 each. Yay! $2 for a novel. You can't beat that. But you'll have to buy all three acts if you want to read the novel. So $6 altogether for essentially, 300,000, 350,000 word novel. And before somebody says, oh, that's not very nice, that's kind of expensive. Yeah, and you spend that much money on your latte in the morning. Well, some of us do. Us starving artists don't, because we can't afford it. Now, Act 2, The Season of Hell. And this is where hell comes to town. Yes, it does. Sorry about that. Right off the bat, part 5, New Girl in Town. And if you think that means what it means, you are absolutely right. We're going to get into, quote, the involuntary transition, unquote. That's what's going to happen. People knew this was coming. It was stated in B for Bewitching that sometime within the next year, Carrie was going to have his involuntary transition. Well, here it is. It's going to happen. And since we didn't see anything happening in Act 1 over the summer, it has to happen at school. It's happening right here. That's exactly what's going to go down. Part five, we'll talk about that. You'll see the lead up to it. You'll actually see it. And you'll see the aftermath. And it's going to occur right there. Our winter of discontent. Boy, that sounds like a happy part. And this is, again, we get into something that's a bit traumatic. This is where things really start going off the rails for the kids. A lot of stress, a lot of heartache. I'm sure some of you are thinking, oh, they're going to break up. Maybe, maybe not. You don't know. Even if they break up, where are they going to go? They only have each other to love, which is, it's a weird trope. And it's kind of strange. What do you do if you do get tired of each other? And who do you go to? You know, everybody's going to eventually find out that, well, you're never going to love them because you love somebody else, but you're sick and tired of them. You can't stay around them much longer. So winter of our disconnect, and something very traumatic is going to happen. And you'll see what happens. Travel logs. Now, this is an interesting part, and this is the only one where I actually have two chapters put in. And let me show you what those chapters are. So right off the bat, chapter whatever, weekend with the girls. That sounds interesting. And chapter whatever that comes after that, the Polar Express. This is something that has been teased for two novels now. And you're finally going to get to see it. So the Polar Express will be Carrie and Emma getting dropped off in the wilds of Canada with limited supplies and a tent and sleeping bags and all that other stuff, and having to make their way back home. It's going to be a bit of an ordeal. It really is. And it's not going to be pleasant. But now, what is this weekend with the girls? Well, originally, when I came up with the idea for the Polar Express, and I actually came up with the idea back around October of 2011 and began filling it out in December of 2011. That's 4.5 years ago. That's how long I've actually had the Polar Express worked out. It was pretty much one of the first major events for the kids that I actually worked out. So that shows you how long this whole novel thing has been gestating. But an original concept, Carrie was going to run off and Annie was going to stay back at the school. And what was Annie going to do? Well, Annie was going to, you know, be like, Carrie's not here. What am I going to do? But that was old Annie. And now that I've been writing Annie, as I feel she acts, she's not going to sit around and pine. Also, there are other things that Annie can be doing. And that's exactly what's going to happen. This is going to be Annie's adventure. And I'm going to give a little bit of a teaser here. She's going to run off with Helena. Now, what does Helena do? Well, if you're thinking what I already know, this is going to be Annie's adventure with the Guardians, working not necessarily alone. Let me just say, this scene is going to be dripping with estrogen. It really will. You're going to see Annie in an environment that she has not encountered yet. But it will be a Guardian thing. It's going to happen. And not only is she running off with Helena, but you're going to discover that there is another instructor at school who from time to time helps out the Guardians. I'm not naming names, but you will find this out. You will find out who this other instructor is that's running off with Annie. Now, since it's called Weekend with the Girls, it has to be one of the women. It could be anyone.
It really could. These two chapters are going to be pretty big. And as it is right now, there's only one other chapter that's going to go in there, and it's going to happen before Weekend with the Girls. And it will be the lead up to these two events occurring. And there will likely be a chapter after the Polar Express showing the aftermath of these two events. So that's one of the things we're going to get into, or I'm going to get into. But the way I write, you're likely not going to hit this part maybe until like the beginning of 2017. So you're going to have to wait a bit to actually see what happens with this section. Sorry, but you know, I'm not Stephen King. I can't write that fast. And keep in mind, I will actually still be editing A for Aware, A for Advanced at the same time. And I may actually change A for Advanced to A for Aware. I'm considering it. Now, last one, Losing Their Religion. I got this from the REM song, Losing My Religion. And according to the lead singer of the band, Michael Stipe, losing my religion is an expression that he grew up with in Georgia. That means basically I'm at the end of my rope and I have nowhere else to go. What do I do? So this is kind of that same situation. They're at the end of their rope. And there are going to be a couple of events that occur in this part that are really going to be highly traumatic. One of them is going to be hinted at in the trailer. You'll kind of see it. And I know some of you, when it pops up, you'll go, yep, something's going to happen. And then there's going to be another event that occurs almost right after that. And it is going to be, I hate to say it, but it's probably going to be pretty brutal. It is not going to be a good time for the kids. In fact, it's going to be a really nasty time for them. I'm sorry, but you know, it's Game of Thrones time, kids. And we're about ready to see them get thrown into some real crap, and this is what's going to happen. So, sorry Annie, sorry Carrie. I'll apologize now ahead of time, but it is going to be pretty rough for you. And then Season of Awakening. Well, obviously, whatever happened in Act 2, they get through one way or the other. And part 3 is Taking Measure. And this is sort of going to be the postmortem of whatever happens in that last part in Act 2, where they're going to recover from this, or at least do their best to recover from it. And a lot of healing, a lot of thinking, maybe even a little bit of sitting down with certain instructors and doing a lot of talking. Part 10, The Final Fears. And this is actually going to contain another major event that will occur. And this is going to be the kids finally coming to grips with all of their fears that have been building up for the last 6 or 7 months and working on dispelling them. Which brings us into part 11, Embracing the Possible. And this is going to follow what happens in the two prior novels. We'll get through the later portion of school. We will resolve various personal and ultra-personal situations at school. We'll get some determination on what's going to happen next, not only for school, but in their personal lives. And then the end of the novel is going to get both kids back home for the summer. And it will set up the next novel that comes after that, D for Determination. It won't go directly into it, but basically there's going to be a skip of only like 2 or 3 days between the end of this novel and the beginning of the next novel. So this'll be the closest. The B level, the C level, and pretty much the D level novel are almost going to run completely together. It's going to be nonstop from the beginning of the B to the end of the D. And I already know how the E level novel starts, and there will actually be a skip of about 3 weeks between the end of the D-level novel and the beginning of the E-level novel. So there you go. So you're going to have 3 novels pretty much just running back to back, showing how their lives occur. This is what I've worked on. This is all, I guess I want to say I'm metaballing here. This is all a very top-down structure. This is how I actually put my novels together. I base a lot of this off of what I have already worked out in Aeon Timelines. So I just go off of the major events that are in Aeon Timelines and I start putting them here. In the next week, I will likely spend a few hours here and there finalizing my own personal thoughts as to what I'm going to do and start making out the chapters. And once I have the chapters mapped out to where I'm satisfied that I'm covering all my points, that's when I'll start putting in the scenes. And some things will change, some things will move around. I may even rename things. I may throw scenes in there that at face value don't work. I may, as I go along, like I did with B for Bewitching, actually add scenes in as I go along. But I have the basic framework mapped out right now. This is my thought process. And after the novel is all laid out, the only thing I have left to do after that is figure out the attendance. I have to figure out who's graduated, who did not get asked back, and how many students are actually coming into the school, and alter all my attendance figures and whatnot so that they reflect the current state of the school at the kids' sea level. So the period that's being covered here is 2013 to 2014. That'll be the last thing I do. Once I get that done, then I'm ready to start writing. I also need to work on the trailer, and then that's it. I'll pretty much have it all ready to go. Let me get you. Let me zoom out here a little bit. There's all my pretty stuff. Nice slow zoom so nobody gets vertigo. So that's it. That's what I've been working on. And that's a part of my thought process, like I said, when I put a novel together. I slowly build it up until I'm comfortable with it. That doesn't mean that none of this stuff will change. The acts are concrete. Those are not changing. The parts are pretty much concrete. They're not changing. What will change will likely be some of the chapters and some of the scenes that are going to go into it, but I haven't started to do that yet. So I still have a bit of flexibility involved. But I will be ready to write come July 16th. And just so you know, July 16th is the anniversary of when Apollo 11 left for the moon. By the time I get to my 2000th post, and that's difficult to say, it should be July 20th, and that is the anniversary of men walking on the moon. So there's a method to my madness. Yeah. And trust me, knowing that I'm setting aside probably the next 500 days of my life to write this novel, yeah, that's madness. But it's a madness I chose. And that's the way us writers are, because we're all a little crazy here. And those of my friends that are out there watching this video who do write, who are novelists, published and unpublished, they know exactly what I'm talking about. So that's it. Hope you enjoyed this video. I know it ran a little long, 30 minutes. It's a long time to sit there, but I hope it was worth it. Take care.